Here comes Stories of the Century, starring Jim Davis and Mary Castle, and it's brought to you free here on the internet by Wild West Toys. I'm Bob Terry, and we'll see you after the show.
Paper files of the early West record many stories of famous and notorious characters of that period. The Wild Bunch of Wyoming, headed by Butch Cassidy, organized one of the most desperate gang of outlaws in the 90s. This hard-riding, gun-slinging band of desperados graduated from cattle rustling to hijacking mainline trains and mainline banks.
Tell you about useless killing. You know it's against my religious upbringing.
I thought he was going for a gun.
You wouldn't even give a man a chance to blow his nose. You know something, Smiley? If you weren't a friend of mine, I'd ride you out of the bunch.
Oh, Butch, you wouldn't do that, would you?
Nah, I guess I wouldn't. Get the money and let's get out of here.
Over $100,000 in bank notes and they ain't worth a crime dime.
I wouldn't worry about it, Smiley. It's still money.
You know this stuff's no good unless the bank president signs it, though.
Here's a dollar bill. You tell me, who signed it?
Well, how should I know?
That's right. Neither does anybody else, for the very simple reason that they never bothered to look. So, all we gotta do is to think up some good signatures and sign them. Hey, Dogface, slip on down to the store and get us some ink and a handful of pens, will you?
Sure will, Butch.
Oh, and Dogface, while you're there, get us a pair of scissors so we can cut these bills apart, will you?
Yeah.
While we're waiting, we'll think up some good, highly respectable names. You got any suggestions, Smiley?
Jack Monroe, the heavyweight contender. And I'll bet 10 of his tens that he flattens Jim Jeffries in the 10th.
I'll take that bet. And now, gents, I'd like to make a suggestion. I nominate, for the 20s, our new president, Bronco Buston and Dead Shot, Teddy Roosevelt! Hooray!
Frank and I were sent down to check on a freight shipment destined for Alma, New Mexico. My name's Matt Clark. My partner is Frankie Adams. We're railroad detectives.
This bill of lading says there's saloon equipment in these crates.
Yeah, signed to Jim Lowe, Alma, New Mexico.
What's this all about, Matt?
The freight bill was paid off with this.
I don't see anything wrong with it.
You would if the boss paid you off on it.
This one's signed by Joan of Arc.
Take a look at this one. Signed by Poker Annie.
How much of this counterfeit was the railroad stuck with?
It's not counterfeit. Two men were killed. $150,000 in unsigned and uncut notes were taken in a holdup.
Well, that's no problem. All we have to do is follow these crates to Alma.
Well, it's not that easy. These bills could have changed hands several times before the railroad got to them. I want you to run a careful check to see if any more of this turns up. I'm going on to Alma. You get back to headquarters, and I'll get in touch with you later.
Sure thing, Matt.
I followed the shipment to Alma. Anyone buying saloon equipment would need the liquor to go with it.
Hey, you the boss?
What you selling?
Anything that goes over the bar.
He's inside.
You know, we may not get any customers, but you fellows will drink enough to show a profit around here. Hey! Take it easy with them boxes. They're full of glass.
Beg your pardon, mister.
What do you want?
I see you're opening up a new saloon.
Yeah, me and my partner's been drinking so much, we figured it'd be a lot cheaper to own our own dive. What are you selling?
Anything you and your partners are drinking. This is some of my private stock. You like it? I can make you a good deal.
Hey, Smiley, the bar's open. Come on over and have a shot.
Yeah. Real smooth.
Yeah. That's pretty good stuff, mister. How much a barrel?
$50.
$50. Fine. I'll take 4 barrels.
Good.
Yeah? What do you want?
Are you the proprietor?
Yeah. Are you a salesman?
I am that.
Hey, I'll be with you in just a minute. Let's see, 4 times 50, that's $200, right?
Right.
Here you are. I always pay cash for my merchandise. When can I expect delivery?
In about a week.
Yeah. Now, what can I do for you?
Whiskey salesman?
Yep.
That's strange. I thought I knew all my competitors. I see you drink my brand.
What do you mean, your brand?
This whiskey is made by the old Laurel Brook distillery that I represent. The finest that money can buy.
See the train go round the bend. Goodbye, my lover, goodbye. She's loaded down with a techie pin. Goodbye, my lover, goodbye.
Hey, mister.
Yeah?
The boss wants to double that order.
Come on, boys.
What's the big idea?
Just walk right on into that barn.
What's a big idea? Not carrying a gun.
Who are you, mister?
Sell whiskey.
You're a new whiskey salesman. Now we're in the town.
Let me have you, boys.
You better think of something to say, mister. Bring him on, boys.
On the ground as soon as your neck stretches about a foot, mister.
Hey, let go of that rope! I've told you time and time again about them useless killings. Hey, wait a minute. I don't want it.
But I'll bet he's a detective.
That's one bet I ain't gonna take, because we ain't staying around here long enough to find out.
But what about our saloon?
Come here, Smiley. We don't want anything more to do with that saloon, see? What we want is a great big dive with a long, long bar just loaded with firewater and dancing girls.
Girls?
Frankie went on back to the Denver office, and I began trying to get a lead on the Wild Bunch. It often happens when you're after men on the dodge, they're never where you expect them. Towns and cities in Utah, North Dakota, and Montana continued to be raided by Butch Cassidy and his desperados. I searched Utah and started moving over into Colorado when the Wild Bunch cut out on a bank and went amok in Nevada. One of the Logan boys was shot during the getaway. Then the bunch disappeared, and things quieted down. Once again, the stolen banknotes with the phony signatures began to show up, this time in San Antonio, Texas. Being a lot closer than I was, Frankie got to Texas first and moved in on a tip-off that a big spender by the name of Jim Ryan had bought a cash interest in the Alamo Saloon.
Boy, Butch, this is a lot. Good.
Yeah, acres and acres and acres of it. I like the new one.
The blonde in the middle?
Yeah, hired her this morning.
Hey, look, she's coming over here.
Please, you're spoiling my routine.
Honey, on you, it looks good.
I'll go around back and see how she likes her new job.
She don't want no hairy-haired cowpoke like you. What she wants is a dude.
Come in.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Ryan.
That last number that you did, my dear, was great.
Thank you.
By the way, they gave you a grand old name, Rosie O'Grady.
I'm glad you like it.
What are you doing tonight after the show?
Well, I have an engagement.
Oh, well, you can just forget that. You see, I've made all arrangements for a beautiful evening.
Oh, hello, Butch. I was gonna...
Well, thanks, Smiley. It was very nice of you. You got here just in time. Thank you very much. The beginning of a beautiful evening. You like champagne?
Well, I've only had it once before, and that was a special occasion.
Well, now, in opening champagne, you've got to be an expert. Watch me. Go ahead! Now, yours.
Thank you.
Mine. Here's to you and me. May our business association get happier and happier, and we get closer and closer as time goes by.
Oh, it tickles, doesn't it?
Not half as much as you tickle me. You know something? Rosie, you're due for a promotion. Instead of getting one of these, you should be getting two.
Why, Mr. Ryan, $20. Is it real?
What do you mean, is it real? Whose name's on that bill?
Why, it says Rosie O'Grady. That's me.
That's what I think of you.
I was wondering if you had a picture of yourself that I might put on my dressing table. After all, I don't want the other girls to date my boss.
Taking over, huh? Yeah, I think it can be arranged. I can have a picture made for you.
Now, if you don't mind, I have to change for my next number.
San Antonio. Frankie was expecting me to meet her here this morning. She didn't show up, but there was a letter. It looked important. Dear Matt, this is a copy of a picture given to me by an old friend. If you recognize anyone in an enclosed picture, you can pick them up at the Alamo Saloon, signed Frankie.
Hi, babe. Wanted to talk to you. Hey, going someplace?
Well, I have a very important business.
Oh, now you can't do this to me now.
Mr. Ryan, control yourself.
Oh, you've stalled me off long enough. Not anymore.
Please.
Come on.
Mm. Wow.
You can say that again. Come on, we're going for a ride.
Where to?
Don't ask so many questions. This is going to be a big surprise. Now, you wait right here. Hey, Smiley, come on, bring it in.
I got it, boss. It's for a perfect figure, medium size.
Here you are, honey. It costs $200, but it'll look like $1 million when you fill it. Come on, put it in.
It's beautiful, but why would I ever wear anything so fancy?
To your wedding, of course.
My wedding? I'm not getting married.
Oh, yes, you are. We're on our way to Laredo now to get married. And after that, we're going to have a long, long honeymoon in Mexico. Yeah. You're invited to the wedding. To the honeymoon. Well, come on, put it on.
Oh, but Mr. Ryan, I couldn't possibly do that. I don't know you well enough.
Oh, yes, you do. Now, let me tell you a thing or two. Whatever the boss says goes. Now, get into that outfit.
You put it away, Smiley. It won't be necessary. Will it, honey?
Well, all right, but I'll have to have some privacy. So why don't you boys step outside, and I'll call you when I'm ready.
And have you duck out on the boss?
Uh-uh.
Now, get that dress on and make it snappy. We're staying.
No, we're not staying. I'm staying. Now you go down and get that champagne and make sure it's good and cold. Well, you can change right behind the screen, honey. Go on. Sure made a mistake, honey. You don't look like $1 million. You look like $2 million.
Put me up, would you, Mr. Ryan?
Mr. Ryan, she calls me. You know, honey, after we're married, we sort of settle down to a nice home life. You could start calling me Butch, couldn't you? Huh?
Would you please get my shawl for me?
Oh, right away, babe. Yeah. You know, I'm not used to handling these lacy things, but how's that? Now, if you'll just take my arm, Mrs., we'll go right down to the coach. After you, dear.
The wagon coach is on its way. Goodbye, poor sucker, goodbye. Another poor fool is hooked today. Goodbye, my lover,
come
goodbye.
Come on, sweetheart. All right, Hank, get moving. Can't keep the preacher waiting.
I'm being forced to become Mrs. Butch Cassidy, main road to Laredo.
There's more to be had in Laredo.
some.
Oh, you have some. Well, that's fine. Here.
Drop your hands.
Hey, Butch, look.
Throw down that gun.
Don't you worry, honey. You're in the hands of experts. Oh, don't shoot, mister. There's an innocent young lady in that coach.
You gents just behave yourself and there won't have to be any trouble.
Oh, we haven't got much money, mister, but we got a lot of goodwill. Would you care to join us in a glass of champagne?
Back there and shut up. All right, lady, step down out of that coach.
You can't talk to her like that. This is the girl I'm going to marry.
Take their guns, Frankie.
Hey.
The joke's over, mister. You know who you're trying to hold up? I'm Butch Cassidy. And that's the smiling kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, Butch. Glad to hear you admit it. Remember me? I'm Matt Clark, a railroad detective.
Well, I'll be a crummy low-down... Looks like we're gonna have to postpone the wedding.
Yeah, for a long while. By the time Wyoming, Utah, Colorado, New Mexico, Arizona, Montana try you for your crimes, you'll be in for life.
Yeah, but they're gonna have to bring me to trial first.
Come on, get in the coach. We're going to San Antonio and pick up the rest of your bunch.
Okay.
Now, I guess that'll take care of you two fellas. I'll get together a big posse and we'll go out and pick up the rest of Cassidy's bunch.
I think I'll stick around for the trial, Sheriff.
All right, Mr. Clark.
Goodbye, Butch.
Yeah, so long, Butch.
You and your romances.
Oh, but she was lovely. She was beautiful. She was gorgeous. But can you imagine me being married to a detective? Hey, Dogface! Come on, get us out of here, will you? I almost busted out laughing when I saw that badge on you.
Put the sheriff back in his squirrel cage and give him his badge back.
The picture had been circulated throughout the States, Mexico, and South America. Frank and I were in the doghouse with the chief for mistaking one of Butch's gang for the constable.
Well, I've always wanted to go to South America.
I sure hope we're not taking this long trip for nothing.
I don't know. The customs officials in Mercedes, Uruguay are pretty positive that Butch and the smiling kid are living there.
I've alerted the Uruguayan police. They'll meet us at the dock.
No sheriffs.
That's Butch, all right. You two men cover the exits. Come on, Frankie.
Mucho guilty.
You know what I'm talking about, money, huh? De Niro, in fact, that. See, I never know a girl yet that couldn't understand money. Oh, girl, you just made it just right.
Break up, Butch. Be the last you'll have for a long, long time.
Seems to me like I've heard that voice before. Haven't I, Smiley?
Yeah.
All right, stop him back there!
December the 5th, Mercedes, Uruguay, South America. Butch Cassidy and the Smiling Kid were killed by the Uruguayan police. This was the end of the Wild Bunch. It took place in a foreign country hundreds of miles away from their killings and robberies.
Enjoyed this episode of Stories of the Century, brought to you free here on the internet by Wild West Toys. You can shop at Wild West Toys at www.toyguntown.com. Thanks again. Hope you'll watch some more of our videos, and I hope we'll see you on down the trail at our shopping site, at our internet site. And we just appreciate you. Thanks again. Have a great day. Howdy, I'm Bob Terry, and thanks for joining us for a fantastic episode of the Western television show Stories of the Century, starring Jim Davis as Railroad Detective Matt Clark and Mary Castle as Railroad Detective Frankie Adams. And it's all brought to you free here on the internet by westernsontheweb.com. Come on by and see us on westernsontheweb.com for hundreds of free Western television shows and movies, and subscribe to our channel here on YouTube, Westerns on the Web. And we're getting our Facebook page started, so come on by and visit us on Facebook, Westerns on the Web on Facebook. Now here comes Stories of the Century. We'll see you after the show.
Record many stories of famous and notorious characters of that period. The Younger Brothers, hardened to the sight of bloodshed and the guerrilla border battles of the Civil War. The Youngers established a record of bank and train robberies that have never been equaled in the West.
Well, here you are, miss. I guess folks out in Virginia don't know much about what's going on here in Missouri, do they?
What?
These cousins you're moving in with. Do you know very much about them?
Should I? Why, what's wrong with them anyway?
Come on, let's get out of here.
Come over here, let me take a good look at you. Mm-mm.
A genuine magnolia blossom from old Virginia, I do declare. Oh, but look at me standing here gabbing. Give me those. You must be faint and famished from traveling all that way.
You're very kind to give me such a nice welcome. You must be Aunt Nellie.
That's right, honey. I've been with this here family since way before the war. And after Mammy and Pappy Younger died, I raised all them boys just like they was my own.
Where are they now?
Oh, there ain't nobody home except John. The rest of them are off down in Indian Nation at Tom Starr's place. And you know, honey, they've been gone an awful long time. I'm awful worried about them
all
boys.
All right, Nellie. That'll do. Go get our cousin some grub.
Yes, Mr. John, right away.
I'm Cousin John.
Yes, I know. Aunt Nellie said you were the only one here.
Let's see, what's your name? I forgot from the letter.
Francis.
Mm-hmm. One of Uncle Rufe's kids, ain't you? Got so many kinfolk I can hardly keep track of them. You won't be here long?
As long as I'm welcome, sir. I can keep the place prettied up and be real useful.
Yeah, I just bet you can. Yeah, I'll pretty it up.
Come on, honey, and fill yourself up. Put the roses back in them pretty cheeks. Oh, don't mind him. He don't mean no harm. None of my boys mean any harm. They just a mite wild and mischievous, maybe. But they ain't bad. No, ma'am. They ain't really bad.
Whether anybody called the younger boys good, bad, or indifferent meant nothing to me. The facts were all there in a stack of warrants a foot high, demanding their capture for an assortment of crimes that included murder and train robbery. For 3 days, I'd been hanging around on the main street of Independence, Missouri, waiting for word from the other operative on the case. My name's Matt Clark. I work for the railroad as a detective. On the piece of paper was all I needed to know. It said the younger gang was down at Bell Starr's place in the Indian Nations. Lieutenant, I hope you can understand why I'm asking you to do this. The cavalry is the only recognized law in the territory.
How many of the youngers do you think are hidden out there?
My information says Cole and Jim.
What do you think they're down here for?
Hiding. They robbed a bank over the Missouri line, then disappeared.
How many men do you want?
Well, they're a tough outfit. All you can spare.
All right. Come with me.
The rest of the men. Saddle my horse and wait in back of the corral. I'll keep busy and give you a little time.
connected only two of them. We were in luck. We had a chance of rounding up the whole gang.
Somebody tipped them off, then you're exactly where we were.
Couldn't have been one of them. They're in as deep as we are.
We can't hold them off here! Separate and run for it! You can make it up that draw!
Wait a minute, Jim. Wait till they draw the Yankees away from us. Then we'll go back down the other side to where the horses are. Oh, see that?
Younger gang were wiped out, but the two leaders, Cole and Jim, somehow made their getaway during the fight. It was impossible to trail them in this wild country. It was up to Frankie to give me my next lead.
That's Mr. Jim, Mr. Cole. That's my boys, all right. I got to hustle up a mess of victuals. My boys are powerful leaders.
Oh, Jim.
Hi, John.
Boy.
How's it been going?
Not so good, John. Not so good. The cavalry jumped us, and we lost a lot of good boys. Oh, you know Bill Chadwick, don't you?
Hi, Bill. How's everything? From Minnesota, ain't you?
That's right. Bill's got plans for us up north. Tell you about it after supper. How are things been with you, John? Any lawmen been hanging around here lately?
No. Great company, though. Cousin from back east.
Oh, the one we got the letter about?
Mm-hmm. Kind of pretty, too. Sort of glad she ain't our cousin.
She ain't.
Been here quite a spell, and I've been asking a lot of questions. Some of the answers she's got down pretty good, and some she ain't got too good.
My, my, you boys sure eat a mess of this.
It was really
mighty good, Bill.
Well, the dessert's coming in. Come on, honey child, help me get the table cleared.
Thank you. What was this you were going to tell me about Minnesota?
Bill here says that's rich farming country. The banks up there are so chock full of money, they don't know what to do with it.
I ain't much heft on it myself. It's too far from home.
Don't mind what Jim says. He'll be going all right. The James boys already set bear for it.
I know for a fact Clell Miller and Charlie Pitts will throw in.
Well, that makes eight of the best all-round gang in the business. Take just about a whole town to stop us.
The reason I'm not so whole hog on the idea is that,
well, you don't have friends at far north. They don't know the back roads or the stream crossing. No one to bring our mail to us or to shoe our horses in a hurry. You just don't want to go on this thing without some thought first.
As long as you're so interested in man talk, cousin, come on in and make yourself comfortable.
Here, here, what's going on in here?
About time you knew the truth, Aunt Nellie. We've been harboring a Yankee spy.
Her?
That's right. She's no more our cousin than she is yours.
Oh, sweet little child.
Go on back in the kitchen and get your dishes done. Go on, go on.
Oh, yes, sir.
What do we do with her, Cole?
Well, if we leave her go back where she came from, the law will be on us as sure as you're born. If she don't get back, the law will be snooping around to find out what happened to her. Any way you look at it, there's bound to be detectives swarming all over the place.
We better be hightailing from Minnesota right now.
Pack your gear and let's get to riding.
You still ain't said who we knew about our country cousin, Cole.
You know, I just had me a premonition, John. I can see you two out horseback riding. And I can see her having a real bad spill. Yeah, a real bad spill.
I'm checking at the telegraph office, but there was still no word from Frankie. I decided not to wait any longer before I investigated. I headed for the Younger Ranch.
Hey, John. Meet us over at Charlie Pitts.
All right, Cole.
Please, Lord, sir, don't let us have no more trouble.
Before we saddle the horses and take that little ride, we must show it in Cousin John a little affection here.
Off of that girl.
All right. Drop that gun. Go on, drop it. All right. Back up.
Go slow.
Go on back.
The Younger boys joined up with Frank and Jesse James and went north. Frankie and I headed for Minnesota by the shortest route. We rode into Mankato, Minnesota on September the 4th, and after some inquiring, learned that several men, well-mounted and armed, had been hanging about the bank the day before, but left when word spread that somebody had recognized one of the younger boys. We alerted every sheriff within a 500-mile radius. We didn't know it until a few minutes later, but a robbery was taking place in this quiet little town of Northfield. A bank robbery that was to become the most notorious in the annals of crime.
All right, let's go.
Inside the bank, the bookkeeper Haywood lay dead. Mr. Bunker, the teller, was wounded in the shoulder. They were brave men. They had refused to open the vault, and the gang had gotten only what was in the till, $50. When I heard that the net was closing around the Youngers over near Medea, I rode hard for that area.
Clark.
Glad to have you join us. They're holed up over there. I've been asking for volunteers to move in and flush them out. If we don't get them out before nightfall, this might go on for another week.
Got me in, Sheriff. I've ridden a long way to join you. How many of them are there?
I don't know.
100 Frank and Jesse, maybe.
I don't know. But sure a high price to pay for a lousy $50. Sure wish I'd get this kid here back to Aunt Nellie.
Maybe we ought to give up.
Be lynched? We'll go out the way we came in with our boots on.
Spread out in the rocks, men. Move in when I give the signal.
Here they come.
still alive? So's Cole.
Well, we'll take him in and patch him up so they can stand trial.
We'll take Charlie Pitts and Luke to trial, because they're dead.
Come on, you men, give us some help here.
Bob was wounded in the chest. Jim had 5 bullets in him and Cole 11. The younger boys were not expected to live, but they proved to be men of iron. They looked so well-bred and gentlemanly. Reporters wondered why they ever traveled the outlaw trail.
Yeah. Yeah, the war did it to us. We fought with Quantrell. When peace came, there wasn't any Southerner that got a break. We had to rob. We're used to hard living. We always had it tough.
Other men fought for the South and lost, but they went home to lead useful lives. Come on, Frankie. Under Minnesota law, a person charged with murder and pleading guilty could not be sentenced to capital punishment. The younger brothers therefore pleaded guilty on November 11, 1876 in Judge Samuel Lord's court at Faribault, Minnesota. He sentenced them to life imprisonment in the state penitentiary at Stillwater.
Oh, Mr. Clark.
Yeah, Sheriff.
I just wanted to find out where to send the reward money. You come in for a share, too.
You have a local baseball club?
Sure do.
Well, then give our share to them. That's the best way I know to keep the kids from becoming outlaws like the youngers.
Well, now, thanks.
We better hurry if we're going to catch that train.
Oh, I almost forgot. This came for you just a few minutes ago.
Where did you say you were going on your vacation?
I told you, Philadelphia. I wouldn't miss a centennial exposition for anything.
Well, then, read this. We've got a new assignment.
All right, so I miss the centennial. Maybe I'll be in time to catch a Kentucky State Fair.
So long, Sheriff.
Bye.
Hope you enjoyed this episode of Stories of the Century, starring Jim Davis and Mary Castle, and hope you'll come on by westernsontheweb.com and see hundreds of free television shows and Western movies, and there's interviews with some of your favorite Western stars. Come on by and see us, www.westernsontheweb.com. I'm Bob Terry, and we hope to see you again on Down the Trail. Have a great day.